Probably we can start. Good afternoon again, future compañeros and compañeras. We are now, your professor and lecturer is now on board, no? And that you already view and watch my lecture last Thursday on political law, and last Friday, yesterday, public international law. And according to Rose, the administrator of the group, 1,800 views already, no, throughout the Philippines. They review my bar lectures on political law and public international law. There are more than 1,800 views already, because if you are a member of the pre-online law schools of the Philippines, you can watch my previous lectures. So this will be my third lecture on commercial law. No, I lectured political law, I lectured public international law, and now I will lecture commercial law. Tomorrow I will not lecture because I have to take my rest, because I will prepare my series of lectures, MCL lectures, before judges, prosecutors, and judges, prosecutors, and lawyers, no? But there are so many lawyers, judges, and prosecutors also watching now, no? So my colleagues, judges, prosecutors, lawyers, good afternoon. They are also watching my lectures, no? They are listening and watching my lecture. Okay, we'll start now. You know, of all subjects in the bar examination, commercial law is the most difficult, and commercial law is the very broad, no? The scope is very, very broad, and this is the most difficult subject in bar examination, no? Commercial law, no? And the coverage are very, very wide, no? Because we have a corporation code, we have negotiable instruments law, we have the insurance law, we have the transportation law, and special commercial laws like AMLA, Anti-Money Laundering Act. Then we have, that's favorite question in the bar, Anti-Money Laundering Law, no? Act, no? AMLA. Then favorite questions in the bar, the Bank Secrecy Deposit Law. Then another favorite questions in the bar is the Intellectual Property Code. Aside from Intellectual Property Code, the Revised Securities Regulation Code. Then we have the Chattel Mortgage. We have the Real Estate Mortgage. We have the Banking Laws. We have the Transportation Laws. We have the Public Safety Act. We have the Omnibus Election Code. We have the Central Bank Act. We have the Comodatum, Mutuum. Then that is very, very wide. Now we have real estate mortgage. Those are the coverage of the commercial law, and also the Code of Commerce. Can you imagine that? No? Even you read the Code of Commerce, it will take 1 year. Even you read the Revised Corporation Code, Republic Act 11232, amending Batas Pambansa Bilang 68, the old Corporation Code, it will take 6 months to read, no? That is why when I teach commercial law review at UE College of Law, I teach commercial law review at PUP, I teach commercial law review at Philippine Law School, I ask the dean that it should be 5 units, not only 4, no? I asked them that 4 units is not enough for 1 week review in commercial law. It should be five units, no? So I always ask them that additional time, hour, should be included, because commercial law is the only bar subjects that is a very, very wide coverage, no? From corporation to negotiable instruments law to insurance to transportation law. Then we have special commercial laws, no? Anti-Money Laundering Act is a favorite question in the bar. Then we have the bank secrecy law, bank secrecy deposit law. That's also favorite question in the bar. Then another one, the intellectual property code. Not always asked in the bar. What is patent? What is copyright? What is trademarks? Is trademarks, copyright, and patent are one and the same? The answer is no. In the case of Coe versus Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court ruled that the patent does not mean it is a copyright. No, copyright, trademark. So I will discuss it extensively in our next hour of lecture. But 2 hours is not enough, so I have to codify my lecture on commercial law. Then another very important special commercial law subject that we will touch is the securities regulation code. That is also favorite question in the bar. Always ask the intra-corporate controversy. In fact, last year, last bar examination, there were 2 questions on intra-corporate controversy. So when I discuss intra-corporate controversy, I will also discuss the revised corporation code, or we call it RA, Republic Act number 11232, or we call it the revised corporation code. So I will discuss the revised corporation code side by side with Republic Act 8799, or we call it as securities regulation code. No, then another favorite questions in the bar in mercantile law or commercial law is chattel mortgage law. We have to discuss chattel mortgage law. Always ask in the bar, in the chattel mortgage law, is a building can be a subject to a chattel mortgage. So if it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? So if it will be asked again in the bar, your answer will be yes, it is can be valid, no? But only valid to the parties. But third parties are not liable because they're not subject. They should be subject to real estate mortgage. So real estate mortgage under Rule 68 of the Rules of Court is also favorite question in the bar. Also, comodatum, no? Comodatum, no? Comodatum is purely gratuitous, no? So for instance, if I borrow your car, I will pitch my parents in the airport, then free of the gasoline, no payments, so it is comodatum because it is gratuitous, not purely gratuitous. But if I will pay it, then it's no longer comodatum, but contract of lease, no? So that is also favorite question in the bar. Banking laws, it is not favorite question in the bar. Public Safety Act, not so. Then the law on common carriage, no? That is also favorite question in the bar, no? So that is also the Code of Commerce, no? But the Code of Commerce, there are only few questions to be asked in the Code of Commerce. Can you imagine that, no? The coverage of mercantile law, or we call it commercial law, is very, very broad. No, can you imagine that? We have the 4 major laws, the Corporation Code, Republic Act, Batas Pamansa Bilang 68, as amended by Republic Act 11232, or the Revised Corporation Code. Then we have the Negotiable Instruments Law. Then we have the Insurance Law. Then we have the Transportation Law. In Transportation Law, always asked in the bar is, what do you mean by common carrier? What do you mean by a private carrier? And what diligence should be exercised, no? So it is a extraordinary diligence, no? Then we will also study culpa kiliana, culpa contractual, and culpa criminal. Those 3 liability always ask in the bar yearly, no? Culpa kiliana, culpa contractual, culpa criminal. So we discuss it extensively. Then AMLA, in AMLA, Anti-Money Laundering Act, always us in the bar. Last bar, it was us, no? So, Anti-Money Laundering Act, no? It now includes even in the in the casino, but there is a threshold of 5 million. No? So if you deposit money equivalent to $10,000, then the Anti-Money Laundering Council will look on it whether that money comes from illegal sources like drugs, like kidnap or ransom, piracy, kidnap or ransom, so on and so forth, no? So, or terrorism, no? Even in insurance, no? You buy insurance, no? Then it is under the Anti-Money Laundering Act. That is favorite question in the bar, no? Anti-Money Laundering Act, no? Also, the composition. I will discuss it if I have time. No? The compositions, the Anti-Money Laundering Council, no? And the Court of Appeals can freeze it for 60 days, but it is the regional trial court have jurisdiction on the forfeiture proceedings, no? We, in the RTC, the Court of Appeals will only issue a freeze order. Another favorite questions at the bar is the bank secrecy deposit law. Last bar examination, it was asked in the bar, the bank secrecy deposit law. In the bank secrecy deposit law, there are exception to the rule, no? If you are under impeachment like corona, no? So if you are under impeachment, then that is an exception to the rule. Or you have a written waiver, no? Or the account or the money involved is under court litigation, no? So those are an exception to the rule, or it is graft and corruption. And we will study carefully the case of Desierto, no? Desierto, wherein Desierto against the manager of the BPI Mendoza, no? This is a landmark decision in bank secrecy deposit law. Because in this case, Desierto was the ombudsman. He wrote a letter to Mendoza, the bank manager of the BPI, to divulge the name of the depositor under his investigation, to divulge the account number, the deposit, the withdrawal, so on and so forth. Then the manager said, no, we are not allowed to divulge the name of our clients, depositors, their account number, the deposits, the amount of deposits, and the withdrawal, no? So it reached to the Supreme Court. The issue is, according to Desierto, Ombudsman Desierto, that it is under court litigation. The Supreme Court told, no, this is not a court litigation because Ombudsman is not a court. Therefore, it is not a court litigation. Remember that, no? Ombudsman is not a court, but it is a prosecution. They will be the one to conduct a preliminary investigation of government employees and officials, no? But if you are not the government officials, or you do not connive with government officials, it should be the Department of Justice. I was a former DOJ prosecutor in the DOJ, no? So we have, if you're not your private crimes, it is the DOJ, no? So another, according to Desierto, that investigation of the ombudsman is like a trial. The Supreme Court ruled, no. So he lost on this case. So we have to study carefully the case of Desierto in bank secrecy deposit law, no? Always ask in the bar. Also, in the intellectual property code, it was asked also last bar examination, intellectual property code, no? So you study the meaning of copyright, you study the meaning of a patent, you study the meaning of a trademark, trade names, no? Is patent the same with trademarks? Is trademark the same with copyright? No, it is not, no? So if it is copyright, it is intellectual or artistic, no? Pag patent, it is an invention for a solution to a human problem, no? Like the COVID vaccine, no? So on and so forth. Then all this asked in the bar is infringement, no? In intellectual property code. So that is why the mercantile law or commercial law is the most difficult subject in the bar examination. And it is the most difficult subject to study because, you know, if you read our revised corporation code, even you read it 1,000 times, you could not understand it, no? You know, they use highfalutin words, no? Yeah, so if you read the negotiable instruments law, the same, no? So that is why the coverage of commercial law is very, very, very broad, and it is very, very difficult. Can you imagine, no? Also included in the mercantile bar examination or commercial law bar examination, the code of commerce. The code of commerce I have here, it's very, very thick. Even for 1 year, you could not finish reading the code of commerce. So that is why my lecture today about commercial law, the entire commercial law, but I will just, that is the backbone of the entire commercial law, no? So we will study it. I will chop it in such a way that I can help you in passing, in tapping the bar. Because last bar examination, one of my students tapped the bar, number two, no? Young lady, a Muslim, was a classmate of Emmanuel Kawilan, my brother, who is also my student, no? She tapped the bar, some number two, no? I produce countless bar top notchers, no? So I hope that some of you here will become bar top notchers. So that is the coverage of the entire mercantile law, or we call it commercial law, no? So but I will deal first the four major laws in commercial law, that is corporation, Batas Pambansa Bilang 68 as amended by Republic Act 11232, or we call it the revised corporation code, then the negotiable instruments law, then I will discuss after the negotiable instruments law, I will discuss the law on insurance, then the transportation law, but I will only discuss in special commercial laws AMLAC, Anti-Money Laundering Act. I will discuss extensively bank secrecy deposit law, because that's favorite question in the bar. I will discuss extensively revised securities code. No, if I will discuss the revised securities code, Republic Act 8799, I will discuss side by side with the revised corporation code. No, because of the last bar examination, there were two questions asked. No. On intra-corporate controversy, no? Intra-corporate controversy is related with Securities Regulation Code or Republic Act 8799, no? So we'll discuss that, then the negotiable instruments law, then insurance, then the last one is the law on transportation. Okay. The corporation code or Batas Pambansa Bilang 68 as amended by Republic Act 11232 or the revised corporation code is 30% in the bar, no? 30 to 35%. So we will discuss it extensively because corporation code is 30 to 35% in the bar examination. So I will discuss first extensively the corporation code. I have here the revised corporation code. We call it Republic Act 11232, or we call otherwise known as the revised corporation code. No. So last week I lectured updates in commercial law. No. So I lectured judges. I lectured prosecutors. I lectured lawyers, no? I like even loadings, no? Because loadings are not exempted, no? They have to take, no? The loadings over there, your law professors were there. That is why they are my students, no? The different loadings are my students. Your law professors, your bar reviewers are my students in MCLE, no? I'm the lecturer in MCLE. Last week, I lectured updates in commercial law. I focus on revised corporation code, or we call it Republic Act 11232. Okay. So I told the lawyers, I told the judges, I told the prosecutors, future compañeros, compañeras, when I lectured commercial law, you know, majority of the lawyers, majority of the judges, majority of the prosecutors could not understand me. Because prosecutors, they know how to prosecute criminal law. Then the practicing lawyer, they practice criminal law, civil law, they practice labor, no? Then, but there are only few lawyers who practice commercial law. So, but if you become a lawyer, I will advise you better practice commercial law. There is money in commercial law, no? There is money. Remember, there is money in commercial law. So when I lectured updates in commercial law, majority of the lawyers could not understand me. So they always ask me a question, no? I'm the only lecturer that I open to any question. So every time that I lectured, somebody stood up, then because if you ask questions to the lecturer, you have to introduce yourself. I'm Justice Juan de la Cruz from the Court of Appeals. I'm expert in the law. This is my question, Judge Pampilo. Can you imagine that? They try to intimidate me. Oh, even you are a justice. We will see. I have to answer your question even outside my lecture. So I told them, no, because I'm expert also in remedial law, no? I always lecture the remedial law, no? So I'm not scared judges, justices who will ask questions, lawyers, no? Law deans, they always ask me questions, no? But they try to put me inside their pocket, no? But they are still my student, no? They have to attend my lecture, no? So last week, I lectured updates in commercial law. I focus on the revised corporation code, or we call it Republic Act 11232. So future compañeros and compañeras and other and all members of the bar who are now watching and listening to my lecture. So under the revised corporation code, there are significant and major amendments now. So I will discuss one by one. What are the major amendments in the revised corporation code? Number one, classes of corporation. So although there is now a revised corporation code, but all classes of corporations are still there, no? We have stock corporation, we have non-stock corporation, we have a limousinary corporation, we have a religious corporation, we have domestic corporation, we have foreign corporation, we have the jury corporation, we have the pacto corporation, we have corporation by estoppel, we have a sole corporation, we have open corporation. They are still existing quasi public corporations. All corporations are still in the revised corporation code. Remember, future compañeros, compañeras, and compañeros and compañeras who are listening to me. They are judges who are watching me, no? In fact, 1,800 watching me every time that I lecture. Now, 1,800 throughout the Philippines, no? Because it is open. As long as you are a member of the pre-online law schools, no? Remember that all classes or corporations are still there, except there is an additional, we call it one-person corporation, or OPC, one-person corporation. Watch out, it will come out in the bar examination. 100%, it will come out in the bar. Remember this, one-person corporation is an additional classes of corporation. Watch out, 100%, it will come out in the bar examination. So what is a one-person corporation? A one-person corporation, you can read it under section 115 of the Revised Corporation Code. It says that a one-person corporation have a single stockholder, no? Only one stockholder by a, number one, by natural person, nag-isala siya, natural person. Second, a trust. Third, estate, no? So those are one-person corporation. No? It is a single stockholder with one natural person, a trust, no? Or a estate, no? Then, banks, quasi-banking corporation, insurance, pre-needs, are not allowed to be a one-person corporation. Why? Why? It is very dangerous, no? Can you imagine that? A bank, only one owner, one-person corporation, tumakbo yan, tumakas. No, the depositors will go after him, no? So it is very, very dangerous. That is why banks are not allowed to become one-person corporation, quasi-banking corporation not allowed, financing corporations not allowed, insurance companies are not allowed, pre-need companies and other companies, no? Even government-owned and controlled corporations, no? Are not allowed, like Lambang. Lambang is government-owned and controlled corporation banks, no? And the DBP, the Development Bank, no? They are not. So remember, the one-person corporation, that is the major amendments in the mercantile law or commercial law. So study it carefully, section 115 up to section 124, no? It's all about one person, 153, one person corporation, because 154 is the prosecution, offenses and penalty, the jurisdiction of the Securities and Exchange Commission. So every time that I lectured commercial law in the MCLE with judges, prosecutors, and lawyers in the bar review, I told them that I'm expert in commercial law. I'm expert in corporation because I have been a corporate judge for 10 years. No? I have been a corporate judge with the Securities and Exchange Commission with 10 years. That is why I'm expert in corporation. I'm expert in commercial law. So I told the lawyers, the judges, the prosecutors that I'm expert in commercial law, no? Because I've been a judge, a corporate judge for 10 years. 10 years. No? So that is one of the major amendments in corporation. Another amendments, no? The life of a corporation, it is now perpetual, no? So the life of the corporation under the revised corporation code is now perpetual. Before 50 years, then it can be extended to another 50 years, then another 50 years, like San Miguel Corporation, three times it was extended, the corporate life of the San Miguel Corporation. But now, under the revised corporation code, the corporate life is perpetual, no? Then another major amendments is that there is what they call authorized capital stock, there is what they call the outstanding capital stock, paid up capital stock, and capital stock, no? So under the new law, revised corporation code, there is no more minimum requirements of the subscribed capital stock. Before, there is, no? So always ask in the bar, what is an authorized capital stock? What is a subscribed capital stock? What is a paid up capital stock? And what is an outstanding capital stock? And what is a capital stock? No? Always ask in the bar, is capital stock the same with authorized capital stock? The answer is no. Is outstanding capital stock same with subscribed capital stock? The answer is no. So you better study what is authorized capital stock, what is subscribed capital stock, what is outstanding capital stock, what is paid up capital stock, and what is subscribed capital stock. Remember, it will come out in the bar again that there is no more subscribed capital stock. No, there is no more. So what is, if it will be asked in the bar, what is unauthorized capital stock? Unauthorized capital stock is the stock that is stated in the articles of incorporation. Nakalagay dyan sa articles of incorporation, that is the authorized capital stock. How about the outstanding capital stock? Outstanding capital stock is the stock that is the total issued stocks, no? So, for instance, the authorized capital stock is 10 million. The issued is only 5 million. So, the issued capital, the outstanding capital stock is only 5 million because that is the total issued shares of stocks. That is outstanding capital stock. How about subscribed capital stock? Whatever is subscribed by the stockholders, by the board of directors, that is the subscribed capital stock. Paid up. When they pay, you know, paid up. But always ask the bar, is capital stock the same with authorized capital stock? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? The answer is no. No. Authorized capital stock is not the same with capital stock. No? As I've said, authorized capital stock stated in the articles of incorporation. But the capital stock is the total asset properties of the corporation. Halimbawa, bumili sila ng land, they buy cars, then that is included. Hindi siya nakalagay sa authorized. So that is the capital stock. Don't confuse with the authorized capital stock, with the capital stock, with subscribed capital stock, with paid up capital stock, and outstanding capital stock. Always ask in the bar examination. Remember, future compañeros and compañeras, including lawyers, judges, and prosecutors who are viewing and watching my live lectures. In fact, according to Madam Rose, there are more than 1,800 watching my lectures, no? 1,800. I am flattered. I talk with Judge Tony Olivete, the RTC judge, who is also an executive judge. Thank you for watching, no? And there are so many judges who are watching, no? And also there are so many prosecutors who my friends are watching, also member of the bar, and even different law deans. There are so many deans in the College of Law are watching me. I do not know, but I'm flattered that they are watching and listening to my live lectures. No, I hope I can enlighten you. So do not be confused of the authorized capital stock, subscribed capital stock, paid up capital stock, and outstanding capital stock, because they are different. No? So that is major amendments. No? Another major amendments, board of directors, no? Section 22, that is board of directors, no? Then section 23 and up to 26, no? So the major amendments here is the disqualification to run as a member of the board of directors, no? Or board of trustees, no? But the members of the board of directors and the board of trustees same, no? 5, not less than 5, but not more than 15, no? So 5 to 15, no? Then, if it is stock corporation, ang term niya is only 1 year. If it is non-stock corporation, like association, 3 years, no? So, the major amendments, it will come out in the bar examination, 100%, no? 100% it will come out in the bar. The disqualification, remember, I will forecast it. It will come out in the bar. The disqualification. Number one, disqualification. You are disqualified to run as member of the board of directors, or if it, board of directors, if it is stock corporation, board of trustees, if it is non-stock corporation. No? So there too, no? Board of Trustees. Pag sinabi kong Board of Trustees, non-stock corporation. Pag sinabi kong Board of Directors, is stock corporation. What are the disqualifications? Number one, if they are convicted of a crime, the penalty, final judgment ito, ha? Hindi on appeal. Halimbawa, sa RTC, sa akin, na-convict na siya, hindi in-appeal sa Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court, that is a final conviction. But if it is still pending with the Court of Appeals or to the Supreme Court, it is not a final final judgment. So, it must be, there must be a final conviction. The penalty is more than 6 years. Remember, it will come out in the bar examination, disqualification, 6 years. 6 years. Another one, if you violated any provision of the corporation code within 5 years preceding the election, then you are disqualified to run as member of the board of directors and member of the board of trustees. Now, second, remember that if you committed any violation of the revised corporation code, no, then you 5 years preceding the election as member of the board of directors or member of the board of trustees, then you are disqualified to run as a member of the board of director or board of trustees. That is number two. Number three, if you violated the Securities Regulation Code or Republic Act 8799, if you violated Republic Act 8799, Securities Regulation Code, then you are not allowed to run as member of the board of directors or board of trustees. No? Tatlo na sinabi ko. No? Number one, final conviction, more than 6 years. Second, violation of the corporation code, provision of the corporation code. Third, you violated the Securities Regulation Code, Republic Act 8799. Number four, if you committed a fraudulent act. No? So every time that we have recitation, I always ask my students, what do you mean by fraudulent acts? For instance, I committed acts of lasciviousness, nanghipo ako. Is that a fraudulent act? O nahalik ako ng estudyante ko? So is that a fraudulent act? I always ask my students, no? So what are fraudulent acts, no? How about you committed estafa? Yes, definitely. Or cyber law, no? Nagnakaw ka ng pera sa ATM, no? So those are fraudulent acts. So if you are committed a fraudulent acts, then you are not, that is number four, you are not qualified to run as member of the board of directors or board of trustees. Last one. So in foreign countries, in foreign courts or regulatory at SEC, if you are convicted what I mentioned, then you also are disqualified to run as member of the board of directors or board of trustees, no? So remember that there are 5 disqualifications. It is very, 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 it will come out in the bar examination. Remember that, future compañeros, compañeras, it will come out in the bar examination. Remember the 5 disqualification, that is the major significant amendments in our corporation code. Batas pamasa bilang 68, now called Revised Corporation Code or Republic Act 11232. So remember that, no? Remember, it will come out in the bar examination. Next, major amendments, no? So, the major amendments, another one is a removal, huh? Removal of the members of the board of directors, no? Or board of trustees, no? It is now the Securities and Exchange Commission who can remove unelected members of the board of directors if it is a stock corporation, or members of the board of trustees if it is non-stock corporation. So, if anybody know that you committed the 5 disqualification, conviction of a final judgment now more than 6 years, or violated the provision of the corporation code, you violated the Republic 8799 or the Securities Regulation Code, fraudulent acts, and so on and so forth, the 5, then you can file a case to the Securities and Exchange Commission, no longer intra-corporate controversy, no? Under the revised Securities Code, it is no longer an intra-corporate controversy, because if it is an intra-corporate controversy, with the amendment of Republic Act 8799, it should be the regional trial court, or we call it the commercial courts, no? So the commercial courts of the RTC have jurisdiction. But in this case, if you are disqualified but you are elected, it is the Securities and Exchange Commission who have exclusive and original jurisdiction, no? You can file a case there, no? They will set for hearing, or the Securities and Exchange Commission can motu proprio, or can initiate, no? Can initiate in filing the disqualification in order that you will be removed as a member of the board of directors, or you will be removed as member of the board of trustees. Remember that. That is a major amendments in our corporation code. The old corporation code, we call it Batas Pambansa Bilang 68. No? So remember, no? Then another one, no? Section 150, no? That is a section of one-person corporation. No? If you create a one-person corporation, di ba, sabi ko nga, a single stockholder, natural person, a trust or estate, no? So, nag-isala siya, no? So, there is a provision in one person corporation. So if for instance, free online law school on the Philippines Inc., no? Then there must be OPC, free online law schools of the Philippines OPC. Ibig sabihin ng OPC, one person corporation. Kailan lagyan ng OPC? There must be sa last word, OPC, you know? There must be an OPC. Ibig sabihin, one person corporation. So it might be asked in the bar, can an ordinary stock corporation can be converted into a one person corporation? What will be your answer? It might be asked in the bar. Or can a one person corporation can be converted into an ordinary stock corporation? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? No? So this is one of the major amendments in our corporation code. No? So under the revised corporation code, that one person corporation can be converted into a ordinary stock corporation. So if you are already a one person corporation, if you want to become a ordinary stock corporation, yes, it can be converted. Or can a one stock corporation can a ordinary stock corporation can be converted into one person corporation? What will be your answer? The answer is yes. I give you an instance wherein an ordinary stock corporation can be converted into a one person corporation, OPC. For instance, stockholder one, he buy all the shares of stocks of the corporations. So he's now the owner of all the stocks. Siya na may-ari. So he can convert it as one person corporation. So it can. It might be asked in the bar. Remember, that under the revised corporation code, a one-person corporation can be converted into a ordinary stock corporation. Then, an ordinary stock corporation can also be converted into a one stock corporation. No? So, as I've said, if he already the owner of the entire shares of stock, so he can convert it to one stock corporation, except if it is, anong sabi sa revised corporation code, if it is a bank, no? Pag banko, hindi pwede. Quasi banking, hindi pwede. Insurance, hindi pwede. Credit, hindi pwede, no? There are or government-owned and controlled corporation cannot be converted into one-person corporation. So remember, section 150, no? Up to by the way, I forgot section 72, no? Section 72, that is corporate books, no? Corporate books and records of the corporation. I will discuss the latest decision of the Supreme Court in the case of Doctora Vicky Belo versus Santos, no? This is it will come out in the bar examination, no? This case. So remember the case of Santos versus Doctora Vicky Belo on Section 72, actually Section 73 under the old corporation code, but under the revised corporation code, it is now called as Section 72, na, hindi 73. Okay. So under Section 72, up to Section 74, it deals with books and records of the corporation. So what are the major amendments here? No? There are in this section 72, 73 and 74, the revised corporation code enumerated now so many records and books of the corporation. Before, ang nakalagay lang stock and transfer book, membership book, ganun na nakalagay. Ngayon marami na, no? So there are so many books and records under the new amendments of our corporation code, no? Section 72 of the revised corporation code, section 73 up to section 74. But I will discuss another amendment, no? The right to inspect. So, the right to inspect and to copy. Under the old corporation code, Republic Act, Batas Pampasa Bilang 68, you can any stockholder, director, a member, or trustees can examine and copy the books and the records of the corporation. Okay. Provided he acted in good faith. No, that was the old law. He acted in good faith within business hours. Now, what is the business hours of the corporation? Siyempre, 8 in the morning up to 5 in the morning. Before, if he acted with bad faith. Wala na ang bad faith ngayon. Tinanggal na. But there is a competitor, not a member, not a stockholder, not a director, not a trustee, cannot inspect the books of the corporation or records of the corporation and copy it, no? So if you are not a competitor, director, if you are not a stockholder, if you are not a member, if you are not a trustee, you cannot examine, copy, and inspect the corporate books of the corporation. So remember, Section 72, Section 73, and Section 74 of the revised corporation code. Then how about foreign corporation? Okay lang, foreign corporation. We'll proceed with section 154 and section 100 up to section 172 of the revised securities code. Because the jurisdiction of SEC in investigation, offenses, and penalties was expanded. Number one, the Securities and Exchange Commission can now conduct investigation. So, they can conduct investigation, they can issue a subpoena, doses tecum, and subpoena ad testificandum. So, under section 115 up to 172 of the revised corporation code, it says that the SEC can conduct investigation and can issue now a subpoena. There are two kinds of subpoena, no? Subpoena dosis tecum and dosis and subpoena ad testificandum. Second major amendments. And under this new, or we call it revised corporation code, Republic Act 11232, the SEC can now issue a cease and desist order good for 20 days. Oh. It is like a TRO, no? Because, you know, RTC, we can issue a temporary restraining order for 20 days. But under the revised corporation code, section 115 up to section 172, the Securities and Exchange Commission can now issue a cease and desist order good for 20 days. No? So, ang 20 days inisyo ng Securities and Exchange Commission is like a TRO, no? That we issued. No? 20 sa RTC kasi 20 days sa amin, pero pag sa Court of Appeals it is 60 days, no? So as if they can issue a TRO, but they call it cease and desist order. Next, that SEC can also issue a permanent cease and desist order. Can you imagine that? That is already an injunction. So, if SEC can issue a cease and desist order, that is a temporary restraining order, good for 20 days, like RTC. Because SEC is co-equal with the regional trial court. No? Ang SEC, ang jurisdiction niya is co-equal with the RTC. That is why we cannot issue a TRO injunction against SEC. Because we are a co-equal body. No? SEC is co-equal body with the regional trial court. No? So we are co-equal bodies. That is why we cannot issue TRO injunction. No? For instance, the issue of cease and desist order, then we issue a TRO. No, we cannot, because it is a co-equal body. For instance, the issue a permanent cease and desist order, then we issued an injunction. We call it a preliminary prohibitory injunction, prohibiting SEC to issue a permanent cease and desist order. We cannot do that because we are co-equal with each other. No? SEC is, the rank of SEC is with the RTC. That is why the decision of SEC is appealable to the Court of Appeals, like RTC. No? Our decision is appealable to the Court of Appeals and to the Supreme Court. Same with SEC. So, if SEC will issue a cease and desist order for 20 days, we can also issue a TRO against the SEC because we are co-equal body. Second, if SEC will issue a cease and desist order, we cannot also issue a preliminary prohibitory injunction because we are the same level, no? Co-equal body. So remember that is one of the major amendments in our revised corporation code. Another one, aside from that, they can search, no? Can you imagine that? They can search and seize things in violation of the corporation code, no? So under section 154 up to section 172, SEC can search, no? SEC can seize. So meaning to say that they can issue search warrants, and through search warrants they can seize things or whatever violation of the revised corporation code. I believe it is unconstitutional, no? It is unconstitutional. Meaning to say, as I've said, I discussed that in my political law review, that only judges can issue search warrants, no? So if SEC will issue search warrants and seize things, then that provision of the revised corporation code, 100% it will be declared unconstitutional. Okay, Mr. Makin Isyan, I think he's a lawyer, asked me what are the jurisdiction of the commercial courts and SEC. Okay, I will give you the jurisdiction. That is always asked by lawyers when I lectured in the mandatory continuing legal education, because majority of the judges and majority of the prosecutors attending my MCLE lectures are not expert in commercial law. So they always ask, judge, I'm a corporate judge. What is my jurisdiction? And what is the jurisdiction of SEC? I said, judges, prosecutors, lawyers, law professors, because there are so many law professors attending my MCLE lectures, and different law deans. The deans are also required to attend my lectures. They are my students. Your deans are also my students. They have to attend my lecture, no? So I told them that if it is an intra-corporate controversy, then it is the commercial court or the regional trial court have exclusive and original jurisdiction over that case, no? So, what is an intra-corporate controversy? In the case of Pabia versus Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court ruled an intra-corporate controversy involves fraudulent actions. Remember, involves fraudulent actions and devices which are detrimental to the interests of the stockholders, directors, and corporation. No? So, detrimental to the interests of stockholders, directors, and corporation. It is one which arises between stockholders and corporation. There is no distinction, qualification, or any exception whatsoever. The provision is very broad according to the catena of cases, so many decisions of the Supreme Court. You know, the case of Pampilo versus Court of Appeals, I was the one who handled this case, no? That it is very broad, no? It covers all kinds of controversies between stockholders and corporation, stockholders against stockholders, stockholders against corporation, stockholders against board of directors, board of directors against board of directors, board of trustees, so on and so forth. It is very broad according to the catena of cases by the Supreme Court. How about election cases? Is it an intra-corporate? Yes, it is an intra-corporate controversy, therefore, with the regional trial court. Okay. How about revocation of the franchise or the certificate of registration of corporations who have jurisdiction? Is it the commercial courts or RTC or SEC? The answer is SEC. No. Whether it is voluntary dissolution or involuntary dissolution, so and revocation, it is the exclusive an original jurisdiction of the Securities and Exchange Commission, not with the commercial courts. Remember that, future compañeros, compañeras, no? Revocation of the franchise, revocation of the certificate of registration of corporations and partnership are not with the commercial courts or SEC or RTC, but with the Securities and Exchange Commission. Another one, in investigating in the commission of violating the Securities Regulation Code, it is the Securities and Exchange Commission, not the RTC. Now, how about filing of criminal cases? You know, when I was with the Securities and Exchange Commission, there was a provision under the old law, Batas Pambansa Bilang 68 or the Corporation Code, as well as Presidential Decree Number 902-A. No, there are so many SEC here. No, I saw them. No, SEC employees are watching me. No, because they know that it is updates in commercial law. There are SEC students and SEC lawyers who are present and watching me in my lecture because they are interested. No, they always ask me. No. Judge June, no? You know, di itong ginamit ko sa, because that is my pin name, no? No, pinatay ko. I'm sorry, somebody called me up, no? I'm sorry. So, dapat, you know, I could not blame them because I were able to tell them that I'm now on board, no, lecturing on the most difficult subject in the bar examination. No? So we now proceed. No? Another, no? When I was with the Securities Exchange Commission, the old law is Batas Pambansa Bilang 68 and Republic Act. And another one is Mami. Si Alex, ginulo ako. Ilan na lang may sa kailangan? Ikaw lang bala ako kumausap. Because I'm lecturing, no? Nasira aking ano. Anyway, I will continue, no? Somebody, si Alex, go ba?
Okay.
Sabihin mo nag-lecture ako. Pambira. Okay, I will now proceed, compañeros, and future compañeros and compañeras. So, when I was with SEC, under the old law, especially Presidential Decree 902-A, we can conduct criminal investigation in criminal violation of the Corporation Code. So, if it is in violation of the criminal violation of the Corporation Code, we can conduct preliminary investigation and file the information in court. You know, when we conducted. Then we file the information. The courts do not want to accept it because you are not allowed under the NAPROS, no? National Prosecution Law, under the rules of court and under NAPROS, you don't belong to NAPROS, no? National Prosecution Office. So therefore, you are not allowed to file information. You know, I filed so many information in violation, criminal violation of the Corporation Code because it is allowed under the old Corporation Code. Also, under the revised Corporation Code. But we are not member of the NAPROS. No? So, under the rules of court, on the rules on criminal procedure, we are not belong to the NAPROS. Huh? National Prosecution Service, no? So therefore, that is why 12 of us lawyers from SEC were appointed as a state prosecutor by the Department of Justice, no? So because of that, I was appointed as a state prosecutor. We call it special prosecutor. We only conduct preliminary investigation on criminal violation of the Corporation Code. And we can now file the proper information because this time I'm already a fiscal prosecutor, no? That is why I am also a prosecutor before my appointment as a judge. No, I'm a prosecutor. At the same time, I'm an MTC judge and RTC judge. No, so that is no. But under the revised corporation code, the SEC can conduct investigation and file cases. Probably same, no? We could not file the information, no? So I will advise the chairman of SEC, you know, the chairman of SEC, attorney Aquino, Emil Aquino is my friend, no? When we were still with the SEC, no? I become a prosecutor, then I become a corporate judge, no? So I will advise the chairman of SEC that you can conduct the investigation, then file the complaint to the fiscal office. Then it is the fiscal office who will conduct the preliminary investigation, and the fiscal office will be done to file the corresponding information, not the SEC, although allowed under the revised securities code or 10 or 20 of the lawyers from SEC will be appointed as special prosecutors of the Department of Justice. So that will be the best. Mommy Water, the best advice I will inform. SEC. Okay, so that is but as long as it is intra-corporate controversy, then it is with the regional trial court. So that is the entire major amendments of our corporation code. We call it Republic Act 11232 or the revised corporation code. Mami, pahing water. Okay, we now proceed with section 2 of the revised corporation code. What is a corporation? So it will be asked in the bar examination, what is a corporation? What will be your answer? A corporation is an artificial being created by operation of law, having the rights of succession and powers, attributes, properties expressly authorized by law or incident to its existence. No? So that is the meaning of corporation under section 2 of the revised corporation code. So every time that I lectured in my review class, no? Philippine law school, no? Because I also handled the commercial law review in Filipino school. I also handled the commercial law review at PUP. I also handled the commercial law review at University of the East. No? So I handled the commercial law review. But other schools like MLC, I handled remedial law. That is why I'm also expert in remedial law. Other law schools, I handled political law like in PCU, no? Philippine Christian University, also in UDM, no? I handle the remedial law. So anyway, so a corporation is an artificial being. So what do you mean by an artificial being? It is not a natural person, no? But it is an artificial being because it have a legal fiction, no? Whatever a natural person can do, a corporation can also do, no? So it is an artificial being. So it is an artificial being. It can sue and be sued. A natural person can sue and be sued. It can acquire property. Corporation, natural person can also acquire property, no? So on and so forth. So same, no? But there is a legal fiction, no? That is why it is called an artificial being. It is created by law. So, it is created by operation of law. All corporations are created by law. No? So, I always ask my students, what law that creates a corporation? You must qualify your answer. There are two laws that create a corporation. Number one, if it is a public corporation, that public corporation is created by a special law. We call it charter. Charter, no? So charter, that so it is created by law. So it is public corporation, it is created by a special law. I will give you an example. I teach at PUP. PUP is a public corporation. It is created by a special law. That is charter. Charter is the law that creates that public corporation. Next, I'm also a judge in the city of Manila. The city of Manila is a public corporation. It is created by a law, charter. I also teach at Philippine Law School in Pasay. It is also, Pasay City is also a public corporation. It is created by a special law. So, if it is a public corporation, it is created by a special law. How about ordinary corporation? No? So, ordinary corporation, like stock corporation or association, non-stock corporation, it is created by a general law. So, where you can find a general law? We can find the general law and the old corporation code. So, what is the old corporation code? Batas Pambansa Bilang 68, as well as Republic Act 11232, or the revised corporation code. So, all other corporation, private corporation, stock corporation, non-stock corporation, are created by a general law. That is Batas Pambansa Bilang 68 o 68, as well as Republic Act 11232. Remember that, no? It is created by operation of law, having the rights of succession. Okay. So, a corporation having the rights of succession. Why? So, it unlike partnership, no? Partnership have no right of succession. So, if a member of the board of directors or a stockholder or a member of trustees or stockholders dies, will the corporation dissolve? The answer is no. Because corporation have the right of succession. How about partnership? The death of any of the partner will dissolve the partnership, because partnership have no right of succession. Remember that, future compañeros and compañeras, that corporation have the right of succession. I will give you an example of my case that reached to the Supreme Court on succession. The case of Baligolf Corporation. Okay. So this is a case of Baligolf Corporation. So, in this case, the Rosa Karam, the mayor of Iloilo, her husband, Congressman Permen Karam, died. And Congressman Permen Karam was the majority stockholder of Baligolf Corporation and at the same time a member of the board of directors. Because Permen Karam died, Rosa Karam wrote the corporation through the corporate secretary as well as the corporate treasurer that he will attend the board of directors meeting because she is the wife, the surviving spouse, and he will attend the stockholders meeting. The corporation denied her request to attend the board of directors meeting, then denied her request to attend the stockholders meeting. And he also asked, so Rosa Karam filed the case against Bali Golf Corporation. Fortunately, the case was ruffled in my sala. So, Bali Golf Corporation filed a motion to dismiss on the ground, the following ground, no? The following ground, that Rosa Karam have no cause of action because Rosa Karam is not a member of the board of director of Bali Golf Corporation, nor a stakeholder of record of Bali Golf Corporation. Second, Rosa Karam, the complainant, have no cause of action because he is neither a member of the board of directors or a stakeholder. That Rosa Karam is not the proper party. Yeah? You know, you still remember parties, no? Proper parties, indispensable parties, necessary parties, and representative parties. He is not a proper party to the case. Therefore, the Bali Golf Corporation asked me to dismiss the case on the ground that lack of cause of action, no personality to file the case. I dismiss it. I dismiss the motion to dismiss on the ground that the corporation have the right of succession. Under the civil code, because the marriage partnership of Rosa Karam is conjugal. Once the spouse dies, automatically the half of the shares of stocks of Permin Karam belongs to Rosa Karam under the rights of succession. No? So therefore, he stepped on the shoes of her husband, therefore, because of the right of succession. After more than 10 years, I saw it in the iskra that I was sustained by the Supreme Court. Again, Judge Pampilo was sustained so many times by the Supreme Court. Now, my name always inscribed in iskra and never been reversed by the Supreme Court. Even the Supreme Court in bank always sustained my decision. So remember, right of succession, powers. So corporation have also powers. So what are the powers of the corporation? So we can discuss the powers of the corporation. So it can sue and be sued. That is for the powers of the corporation. It can have continuously a corporate seal. No? Then it can acquire properties, no? Whether real or personal properties. It can distribute dividends, whether cash, shares, whether it is property, cash, or shares of stocks. It can enter into contracts. It can donate. It can increase its capital stock, authorized capital stock. It can amend its articles of incorporation. It can amend its bylaws. So those are the powers of the corporation. Powers, attributes, no? What is attributes? A corporation have a separate and distinct personality from the board of directors or trustees or stakeholders or members, no? It have a separate and distinct personality. If you file a case against the corporation, do not include the board of directors, do not include the board of trustees, do not include the stakeholders, do not include the members, but only the corporation. For instance, Judge Jun Pampilo versus pre-online law schools of the Philippines Corporation. So I will not include you being a member, no? So, because that is attributes expressly authorized by law or incident to its existence. So, there is expressly authorized by law. If it is expressly authorized by law, that's primary franchise. Then, or incident to existence, the secondary franchise, because corporation will only act within the boundary, we call it, they should act within the boundaries of the law, no? Within the primary purpose, no? Or the primary franchise, no? Because if not, it will be called ultra viris act, no? It is an ultra viris act. You know, I have a decision wherein the Supreme Court in bank decided, wherein I got 15-0. No, that is the only decision of a judge in the entire history of the Philippines. That is decision or was the sustained by the Supreme Court in bank with a perfect score of 15-0. Yours truly only. But I beg to disagree the wordings of the dispositive portion of the Supreme Court in bank. Because in this case, I said that Executive Order 179 issued by the President of the Republic of the Philippines delegating police power to MMDA is in violation of the doctrine of separation of powers, checks and balances, and the President encroaches the powers of Congress because there is the doctrine of separation of powers. The Supreme Court sustained my decision, and the Supreme Court said it is an ultra viris act of the President. Can you imagine that? I beg to disagree, but Supreme Court, whether the Supreme Court is correct or not, that is the wording of the Supreme Court said, it is an ultra viris act of the President, affirming the decision of Judge Pampilo. Is the President a corporation? Huh? Future compañeras and compañeras, will you agree that the President of the Republic of the Philippines is a corporation? It is an ultra viris act? No! But whether the decision of the Supreme Court is wrong or correct, but it becomes part of the law of the land. So, for me, it should not be ultra viris act, no, because it will only involve corporation. Okay. Anyway, that is the decision of the Supreme Court and becomes part of the law of the land. That was my decision in the history of judiciary. Never been. I'm the only judge who got a perfect score of 15-0. Not a single justice of the Supreme Court dissented my decision. Shout out naman dyan. Future compañeros, compañeras, shout out. Shout out. Okay, next. What are the components, composition of corporation, no? So, number one, there is incorporators, no? Incorporators, then we have corporators, then we have board of directors, then we have board of trustees, we have stockholders, we have members, we have corporate officers, then we call it promoters, no? Those are the composition of the I will not discuss it extensively because I have only remaining 30 minutes, no? That is why I always said that when I lectured in the Bar Review, I only given 4 hours. I said to the dean, dean, please give me at least 5 hours to discuss the entire commercial law or mercantile law, because it is the scope is very, 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 very broad. I could not finish it even for 10 hours. So what I did is that I have to concise and lecture brief, no? Then I will just lecture it in such a way that I believe it will come out in the bar examination. So remember, future compañeros and compañeras, I have already remaining 30 minutes. Anyway, I will proceed. Always ask in the bar, How you distinguish between corporation and partnership? Always ask in the bar, doc. So although there are other questions now, but always ask in the bar, how you distinguish between a corporation and partnership? Number one, in its creation, corporation is created by law, while partnership is created by agreement of the parties. Second, corporation composition. So the composition of corporation, not less than 5, but not more than 15. In partnership, 2 or more persons agree to form a partnership for profit, and they will distribute money, property, or industry. No, so 2 or more person. So that is partnership. Next, that corporation have the power of succession. So the death of the stockholder, the death of a member, the death of the board of directors, trustees will not dissolve the corporation, but the death of any of the partner, especially capitalist partner, then automatically partnership will be dissolved. Next one, that in corporation, it is the board of directors, if it is a corporation, and it is the board of trustees, if it is not a corporation, who will manage the business of the corporation? Remember that the board of directors or board of trustees will be the one to manage the business of the corporation. While in partnership, it is the managing partner. Now, remember that, future compañeros. No? So, if you, because the board of directors, section 22, no? The board of directors, in the board of directors is the one who will exercise the board of directors and board of trustees. The one who will exercise the powers of the corporation, the board of directors, the one who will manage the business of the corporation, the board of directors, the board of trustees will be the one to hold all the properties of the corporation. Remember that, compañeros and compañeras. But in partnership, it is the managing partner. Remember that, doc. So I have already 25 minutes left. No? I could finish anyway. I will just continue my lecture. So future compañeros and compañeras, and there are judges, there are prosecutors, and there are lawyers attending my lecture. Okay. Next. So, classes of corporation. So, what are the classes of corporation? Always us in the bar, future compañeros and compañeras, is de jure corporation, de facto corporation, corporation by estoppel. Remember that, de jure corporation, de facto corporation, and corporation by estoppel. But, 100%, remember this, one person corporation will be us in the bar. 100%. One person corporation, you must study section 115 of the corporation code, because it deals with the provision of the one person corporation. So remember, in one person corporation, it is the single stockholder. Sino yan? Single stockholder, a natural person, human being, a trust, or a state. No. So remember, no? So it will come out in the bar. Although there are other corporations. So we have a stock corporation. We have non-stock corporation. We have private corporation, we have public corporation, we have quasi public corporation, we have eleemosynary corporation, we have religious corporation, we have educational corporation, we have soul corporation, we have open corporation, we have foreign corporation. Oh, by the way, foreign corporation is always asked in the bar, no? So remember, foreign corporation. But this time, one person corporation will be asked in the bar examination. But you still have to study different kinds of corporation. But when I lectured in the bar review, especially in pre-week, I have to compress my lecture, no? I will adjust lecture that I believe it will come out in the bar examination. Watch out! It will come out in the bar. Yes, sir! Come out in the bar. Remember this, no? So better attend my pre-week lecture. That is 1 week before the bar examination. I will make a forecast. What will be the questions will be asked in the bar examination. So remember those different kinds of corporation. How about different kinds of shares of stocks, no? So we have common shares, we have no value shares, par value shares, we have voting rights shares, we have preferred shares, we have but only us in the bar, treasury shares. So you have to study what is the meaning of treasury shares. Treasury shares, founder shares, redeemable shares, those are favorite questions in the bar. And watered shares. What is a watered share? Always ask in the bar. Remember that. Watered shares. So there are so many kinds of shares. But one of them is the best. I believe watered shares. Redeemable shares, you better study it. Treasury shares, founder shares, and water chairs. Always ask in the bar examination. Remember that, future compañeros and compañeras. Remember that different kinds of shares. No par value shares, par value shares, common shares, voting rights shares, preference shares, founder shares, so on and so forth. So you just study different kinds of shares. Then, corporate life. So, as I've said, the corporate life is now perpetual, no? So perpetual, unless otherwise provided by the articles of incorporation. No? Then, if the corporation, after its incorporation, I need to say, after the certificate of registration issued by SEC fails to do its business, then it will be revoked, no, or suspended. The revised corporation that said shows delinquent, will be declared by SEC delinquent. Dalawa yan, no? 5 years or already operating his business pero huminto, no? Huminto siya after 2 years, then it can be either revoked or declared delinquent. Delinquent nakalagay dito, eh. Delinquent, no? So delinquent nakalagay sa bagong batas natin. Delinquent, no? Then we proceed with other topic na board of directors. So, section 22, board of directors. So the board of directors, 10, less than 5, but at more than 15. No? So if it is non-stock corporation, the term of office of board of trustees is 3 years. But if it is stock corporation, 1 year. But there is what we call holdover capacity. He's still a member of the board of directors even beyond 1 year. Until and unless there is a new elected qualified members of the board of directors, no? So then it is the board of directors who will operate the business of the corporation. It is the board of directors and board of trustees who will exercise the powers of the corporation. It is the board of directors and board of trustees who will hold the properties of the corporation. So that is the board of directors. Now, then removal of the board of directors. The board of directors can be removed with or without consent. Now, so a board of directors can be removed without its consent. So, the board of directors can be removed with or without its consent. But there must be a notice. Why notice? Because if there is notice, then there is no due process. I discussed it in the political law that there are different kinds of due process now. Procedural due process and substantive due process, criminal due process, administrative due process, as well as procedural, as well as administrative due process. So one of the essential requisites in due process is notice. So before you can be removed, if you are a board of director or board of trustees, before you can be removed without consent, then there must be a notice without any legal grounds, no? You can be removed without any grounds, no? Ano ba? Masama ang tingin sa mukha mo, no? Pangit ka. So they can remove. Then another one that it is if SEC find out or anybody find out that you are disqualified to run as member of the board of directors or board of trustees, then it is the Securities and Exchange Commission who will conduct the hearing, no? So what are the disqualification? I discuss it, no, but I will repeat it because 100% it will also come out in the bar examination. Number one, if you are convicted by final judgment of a crime, the penalty is more than 6 years, no? So what are cases, criminal cases, that the penalty is more than 6 years? So, siyempre, prison mayor. Because in prison mayor, 6 years and 1 day to 12 years. Then, prison temporal. Prison temporal is 12 years and 1 day to 20 years. Then, reclusion perpetua, no? But, prison correctional, aristo mayor, aristo minor, they can still run as member of the board of directors. Then, second, if you committed any violation of the corporation code within 5 years preceding the election, then you are also disqualified to run as member of the board of directors. Number three, if you committed within 5 years preceding the election, Republic Act 87-99, or we call it the revised securities code, then you are not allowed to run as member of the board of directors. And the last one, if you committed a fraudulent acts, now you committed fraudulent acts, then you are not allowed to run. And that, yeah, you committed any of them, now in a foreign country, no, or regulation like New York Stock Exchange. So remember, compañeros, future compañeros and compañeras, the disqualification, 100%, it will come out in the bar. Remember that. Remember, the five, disqualification, put it in your mind, it will come out in the bar examination. Remember that. Then we proceed with the powers of the corporation. I said that it is the board of directors, if it is stock corporation, that it is the board of trustees, if it is non-stock corporation, who will exercise the powers of the corporation. So, it is the board of directors, if it is stock corporation, or board of trustees, if it is non-stock corporation, who will exercise the powers of the corporation. So, what are the powers of the corporation that will be exercised by the board of directors and the board of trustees? Number one, to sue and be sued. So, they are the one who can sue and they are the one who can be sued, but in the name of the corporation. By the way, future compañeros and compañeras, I failed to discuss piercing the veil of corporate entity. I was not able to discuss it, no? Because piercing the veil of corporate entity always asks in the bar examination. What do you mean by piercing the veil of corporate entity or disregarding the separate personality between the stockholders, board of directors, trustees or members to the corporation? So how it will be disregarded? Or we call it piercing the veil of corporate entity. So how it can be disregarded, the separate and distinct personality? Number one, if the corporation committed a crime. So if the corporation committed a crime, then for instance, we establish a corporation because we will manufacture shabu. So then piercing the veil doctrine will come in. Second, if we committed fraud. Third, if we avoid taxation. Fourth, if we committed violation of the anti-dummy law. No? So remember, piercing the veil of corporate entity, it always asks in the bar yearly. Piercing the veil of corporate entity, remember that, future compañeros and compañeras. Okay, next. Powers of the corporation. It can sue and be sued. It can acquire a perpetual corporate seal, no? It can acquire property, whether real or personal, but always as in the bar, amending articles of incorporation. Yes, it is the power of the corporation to amend its articles of incorporation. But there are two legal requirements here. Number one, there must be majority vote of the board of directors if it's a stock corporation, or majority vote of non-stock corporation. Then, second requirements, there must be an affirmation of vote of two-thirds vote of the outstanding, remember, not the authorized capital, outstanding capital stock. I only discuss it. What is the meaning of outstanding capital stock? The outstanding capital stock is the total stock issued by the corporation. Doon kukunin yung two-thirds outstanding capital stock if it is stock corporation. Then two-thirds vote of the entire membership if it is non-stock corporation. Remember that. So remember, no? Also in disposing properties, no? Those are the powers of the corporation. They can enter into contracts. They can buy properties, whether real or personal. So they can enter into management contracts. So you better study different powers of the corporation. So it is the board of directors, or board, if it's the corporation or board of trustees, will be the one who will exercise that powers. Okay, next up, we proceed meetings, meetings, bylaws and meetings, no? So in bylaws and meetings, always ask in the bar is proxy and voting trust agreement. So what is a proxy and what is a both interest agreement. So remember, future compañeros, compañeras, a proxy must be in writing. All proxies must be in writing. No proxy orally. It must be in writing. Second, it is only intended for one purpose. No? So there must be a date. No? The maximum period of the proxy is 5 years. No? 5 years. How about voting trust agreement? Voting trust agreement, it is an agreement between two or more stakeholders to another person who will represent them in a board of directors, in a stakeholders meeting. No? So, in voting trust agreement, it must be in writing and must be notarized. No? That is their difference. In voting trust agreement, it must be notarized. And that 5 years. So, but it can be extended. For instance, there is a voting trust agreement of the creditors wherein they agree that until and unless the loan will be fully paid, then they can still attend the board of directors, a board of stakeholders meeting. So that is voting trust agreement. When I attended the stakeholders meeting of San Miguel Corporation, I was the assistant corporate secretary. So there were so many battery of lawyers arguing with me in validation of a proxy. Then the big law office said, Attorney Pampilo, we move that these proxies, 10 proxies, will be invalidated on the ground that it is not notarized. Can you imagine that? That is notarized. Then I said, okay, compañeros, compañeras, I have here corporation code. Give me a section or provision in the corporation code that proxy must be notarized. If you can give me that, I will resign as a judge. I will resign as a lawyer. Tell me. They could not. It is not a requirement. No. Notarization of a proxy is not a requirement. But if you notarize it, yes, well and good. Why? Why? Well and good. Why? Because once it is notarized, it becomes a public instrument. Remember, in bylaws and meetings, all is us is proxies and voting trust agreement. No? Then regular meeting and special meetings, I will no longer discussing it. No? I will just proceed with stocks and stakeholders because it's also favorite question in the bar. Then, if I have time, no, 5 minutes na natira. If I have time, I will discuss corporate books and records of the corporation, section 72. No, I discuss first stocks and stakeholders. No? So stocks and stakeholders. So you better memorize the meaning of subscription contracts. Now, what is a subscription contracts? You must memorize the meaning of a subscription contracts. Now, then there are two kinds of a subscription contract. One is pre-incorporation subscription contract, and another one is post-incorporation subscription contracts. Always ask in the bar, which of the two is irrevocable within 6 months? Is it the post-incorporation subscription contract, or it is the pre-incorporation subscription contract? it will be asked again in the bar. What will be your answer? The answer is, it is a pre-incorporation subscription contract. It is irrevocable within 6 months. But there are exceptions to the rule. What are the exceptions to the rule? If all of the subscribers will, if all of the subscribers will consent for the revocation, yes, no, or the corporation did not pursue, that is the exception. But remember, in a pre-incorporation subscription contract, it is irrevocable. Remember that. Future compañeros, compañeras, in order that you will tap the bar, I want you to tap the bar or pass the bar examination. It is irrevocable. How about pre-incorporation? Ah, yeah. Opposed. It is revocable. That is very, very important in stocks and stockholders. Also, how about if the stocks will be declared delinquent? What will happen? What will happen if the stock will be declared delinquent, that it cannot vote and be voted upon? It cannot receive dividends, no? So who will be the one to declare the surplus tax delinquent? It is the board of directors, or under the subscription contracts, there is a term there that you will pay. No? Then the next is if the shares of stocks is lost, is stolen, or destroyed. So if it is, if the certificate of stock is stolen, destroyed, or lost, what will happen? No? So you study it now. You file an affidavit, triple plate, to the corporation, stating the facts why it lost. No? So if the panel that is correct, then within 1 year, the corporation can issue a duplicate certificate of shares of stock. But if somebody will question it, hindi totoo, nanawala, hindi totoo, binili ko, so what will happen? Then the case will be heard before the commercial courts. Then before the commercial courts, no? The corporation will not issue the duplicate certificate of stock until and unless the court will decide. It is also favorite question in the bar examination. I have the remaining two minutes now. The last one is section 72 of the revised corporation code, that is corporate books and records. So there are corporate books and records that you can examine, provided within the principal office of the corporation. Second, within the business hour, and that you are not a competitive director or stockholder, or so on and so forth. No, those are the one. No? So the following are books of the corporation. No? If it is stock corporation, we call it stocks and transfer book. If it is non-stock corporation, membership books. No? Then we have the general information sheet, the financial statement, the board resolution, the stockholders meeting, whether it is regular or special, the board of trustees meeting, whether regular or special, stockholders meeting, whether regular or special, the membership meetings, whether special or regular, no? Those are financial statements. Those are the records. And if the corporation will not allow you to inspect, what will you do? You file a case to the regional trial court or commercial courts, because it is an intra-corporate controversy. What is an intra-corporate controversy? You know, in the case that I handled, in the case of Pampilo versus Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court ruled an intra-corporate controversy involves fraudulent actions and devices which are detrimental to the interests of stockholders, directors, and the corporation. It is one which arises between stockholders and corporation. There is no distinction, qualification, nor exemption whatsoever, as the provision is broad and covers all kinds of controversies between stockholders and corporation. It ends my lecture. Future compañeros, compañeras, shout out yan! Shout out! I hope that I impart to you my knowledge being an expert in commercial law. Also judges, thank you for watching, listening my lecture. Also prosecutors and all lawyers who are listening my lecture. In fact, there are so many schools already called me up. They want me to lecture, but my first priority is MCLE. Why? In MCLE, my per hour is 3,500 to 5,000. Okay, thank you very much, future compañeros and compañeras. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Namit mingin ba ako ng libro?